Parshat Miketz, Shabbat Chanukah. Chanukah is a very, very famous festival. More famous, perhaps, than one would think, since it's rabbinical and not biblical, because it comes out during the Christian holiday season in America, and therefore the Jewish holiday season, our Chanukah, is all of a sudden pushed to prominence. We recite in the grace after meals and in the Amidah the very famous Al Hanisim prayer, in which we thank God for the miracle of Chanukah. And the prayer begins as follows. In the days of Mattathias, the son of Yochanan, the high priest, Thesmonian and his children, when the wicked Greek-Syrian government rose up against the people of Israel and wanted to cause them to forget your Torah, wanted to take them away from the laws that you wish them to perform, you, the Almighty God, stood behind them and enabled a small band of Hasmoneans to conquer the wicked Greek Syrians. This story, by the way, from this perspective, is also repeated in an ancient source in the tractate Shabbat 21, where there's also a picture of the Holy Temple desecrated by the Greek Syrians, and how the Hasmoneans won the battles, rededicated the temple, purified the menorah. The problem with this, however, is that it's not at all historically accurate. The problem with this is that from a historical perspective, it was a whole different story. The battle in Judea was a civil war. That's how it started, of Jew against Jew. Let me just try to explain a little bit of the history. The Holy Temple, the first Holy Temple, was destroyed in 586 BC. The Jews were carted off to Babylonian exile. 50 years later, they were given permission by Cyrus of Persia, who had conquered the Babylonians, to return to Judea. They rebuilt the temple. And a few hundred years later, the Jews were a flourishing, small nation, but developing very, very nicely. The problem was that Alexander the Great, who was one of the heirs to the dynasty of Cyrus of Persia, Alexander the Great was a Hellenist, and he was spreading Greek culture throughout the Hellenistic world, and that included Judea. And even the high priest and the priests who led the government of Judea at that time were becoming assimilated Hellenists. And they wanted to turn Judea into a Greek city-state, with Olympic games to the mythological gods on Mount Olympus. And the situation was appalling, and it looked as if Hellenism was taking over Judaism. There was a small band of Hasmoneans, similar to those who study today in Merkaz HaRav Kook, Yeshivot Hezder. They were brave. They trained themselves in warfare. And they started a battle against those Hellenistic Jewish leaders, a civil war for the sake of Torah, for the sake of purity. And they won, miraculously. And rededicated the temple and purified Judea from all the Hellenistic influences. Now, when they began to be winning, the high priest called in the Greek Syrians to help against these religious Jewish upstarts. And that's how the Greek Syrians came in. Once they came in, they became extremely cruel. And they forced the Jews not to be religious. They forced the Jews to bow down to idols. They forced the Jews to eat pork. But it started with a civil war. And the question is, how come this civil war is not mentioned by any of our traditional Jewish sources? I want to raise another question at the same time. The battle and the victories of a small band of religious Jews was a great miracle. Why was it necessary for there to have been a second miracle, the miracle of the small cruse of oil that was only enough to last for one day and lasted for 8 days? The miracle of the oil of the menorah. Why did God have to make two miracles? That second miracle is featured as being the major miracle in the source and tractate Shabbat. I want to answer both questions. In Judaism, we sometimes face two different kinds of enemies. The Gentile enemy from without who wants to destroy us physically. Our own Jewish leaders who have gone far away from Jewish tradition, who do everything they can to destroy us internally. Judaism is clearly against raising arms against one's Jewish brothers. You want to defeat the Jewish assimilationists. You want Torah to reign supreme. You have to educate. Ner mitzvah v'torah or, the candle symbolizes our commandments and Torah symbolizes light. You have to teach the light of Torah. You have to educate, not force Jews into submission on religious issues. The Gentiles who want to destroy us physically, against the Gentiles we can fight. The miracle of the little bit of oil, education and Torah and the light of Torah, that is when we're fighting against our own brothers. And it has to be with the armaments of Jewish education and the light of Torah. When you're fighting against the Gentiles who want to destroy you, and Iran who is threatening you with nuclear weaponry, then you have to fight with all you've got physically. When the rabbis are talking about the great miracle of military battle, they start in the middle, when our enemy were the Greek Syrians. They do not want to eternalize the civil war of Jew against Jew. I would say that for the great rabbis, it would be forbidden to lift any kind of weaponry against a Jewish brother. And that's why the story of Chanukah always comes out during these portions of the Torah that describe the relationship between Joseph and his brothers. The brothers, as I explained last week, were against Joseph ideologically. God was not his center at this point. Joseph seemed to be falling into the assimilation of Egyptian life. The brothers were wrong for getting rid of Joseph. They should have taught him, loved him, and brought him close. Chanukah comes at this point in the Torah readings, so that the story of Chanukah is reinforced by the story of Joseph and his brothers. Jew against Jew ideologically, it must be with love and Torah teaching that you win over your fellow Jew. Only against Greek-Syrian enemies is it okay to use actual weaponry of warfare. Chanukah Sameach, Shabbat Shalom.